Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
We are swimming.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
In the ocean of the Spirit.
Thank you, Jesus.
Rain the Holy Ghost. Rain the Holy Ghost. We are pouring.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Because we are filled to overflowing.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Say, we are swimming.
In the name of Jesus, Father, break up fertile ground, break down stubborn wheels, Father, and we go into the study of this word. Give us clarity, give us understanding, and we utilize your word, God. We will not use it, oh God, for personal gain or even fleshly purposes, but to advance the kingdom, that your people will grow thereby. That you would open up our understanding, God. Give us seeing eyes and hearing ears, that you would speak to us this day. Show us your purpose in this word, God. Let Joel 1 speak for itself. Let it speak, oh God. Speak through this word. Speak through this word. You are the living word. Let Joel live in our life today. Calls us to hear the word of Joel. Help us to hear the purpose, the intent, in Jesus' mighty name. We give you praise for what you're doing, how you're doing, God. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah. Oh, God, you know how to lift us. You know how how to bring us in. You know how to forgive us. You know how to strengthen us. And we give you praise for what you're doing. Hallelujah. We give you praise even right now for this word. We give you praise right now, Heavenly Father. We give you praise. We give you the praise. We give you the praise. We give you the praise. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Let this word live in us. Let this word live continually 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 in us. Let this word of God, let this word live in us continually in the mighty name of Jesus. This word will live in us. This word will have free course in us in the mighty name of the Lord. This word will come alive today. This word shall come alive today. This word, oh God, hallelujah. Hallelujah. This word shall come alive in us today. In the name of the Lord, we pray. In Jesus' matchless name. Thank you for your word. Thank you for this truth. Thank you for this people. Thank you for what you're doing. Thank you for how you're doing it. Thank you for this people, oh God. Thank you in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, glorious God. In Jesus' matchless name. We give you all of the praise, the glory, and the honor. Hallelujah. God blessings to all of you that are with us on today. Amen. I see you, Pastor Deborah. God's blessings to you. Amen. God blessings to you, Pastor Deborah. We thank God for you. I certainly wish that you were able to be with us when we went to New York. We just came back from New York from a beautiful, beautiful banquet with Evangelist Sterling and Dr. Kennedy, amen, who has been on the Lifeline with us. We've been on their line, the Bible Book Club, and they've been on the Lifeline, and they've given us an invite because they wanted to award their people who have been coming on the line and ministering to the people of God, and this was their way of showing kindness unto us. Amen. And we were able to go. We were able to, amen, blessings to you. We were able to participate. And I thank God, amen, for, amen, what the Lord has done. And it is indeed marvelous in our eyes. My God, they showed up. New York, y'all showed out. Bronx, you showed out. I thank God for you. Thank God for what you've done for all of us. Amen. It wasn't many of us from the Lifeline who were there, but the ones that were there were really blessed. And we really had a jubilant time. We thank God for such a wave of his glory. We was able to not only stay there for the banquet that Saturday, but also to attend their service with the Bible. Hallelujah. The church is not named Bible Book Club. But we was able to be there. We was able to glorify God in the house with those believers. My God, we had a super, super time. Thank God for Bishop, DeRue. I hope I'm pronouncing his name right. But God blessings to him. God blessings Dr. Kennedy. God blessings Evangelist Sterling. God blessings to all the people that we were able to meet and fellowship with. Amen. And we're going to continue to do this. Amen. We're going to continue to grow and excel. Amen. So, Pastor Cooper, I just want you to know that you were missed. Stephanie Bush, you were missed. We're going to keep doing this, and we will return. They will be doing this again on next year. Lord should delay his coming, and we'll have that opportunity. We're given that opportunity again. We are coming, and we want to be a blessing to them as they have been a blessing to us. So thank you. Thank you for your prayers. I know I've been missing a bit with our Bible study. I've been missing a bit, but we thank God that we have the occasion to be here today. So we are not going to delay. We're going to get into our lesson. Amen. A beautiful lesson. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You already know. You already know, Pastor Cooper and Sister Stephanie, that we are not counting you guys out, that when we have an invite or we're doing a work for the Lord in another part of another state, or even here, we definitely want you all to be a part. Amen. We see you from this place right here, from the Lifeline and from the Prayer Mergers Group. We see you as family. We embrace you as family. So thank you for your prayers. Amen. And it just lets us know that we have so much to do and that God have people in place that they know how to encourage us. God blessing to you, Apostle Harrison. God blessing to you, sir. So happy to see your presence with us on this day. Blessings of the Lord rest, rule, and abide with you. Amen. We're going to look at our lesson, and we're not going to delay any longer. We've been asking God to lead us and guide us, and we've left the historical books of the Old Testament, from Genesis up to Job. And then we've taken a vacation from there, and then we went to the New Testament. We finished the books from Matthew through Revelations. We finished that. And then we decided we'll come back to the Old Testament and pick up, and we're looking at the prophetical books. And so we've dealt with Obadiah, and we've also dealt with Jonah. And today we're starting our a closer look at the book of Joel. The book of Joel. Now, for those of you who have been following us or you're new to this teaching, I don't want you to view this teaching as some deep theological insight into the Word of God, but I want you to see this teaching as the basic. I want to motivate the people to read, to study, and to pray. So in this and this setting of teaching, you know, we have some scriptures today, but don't expect a whole lot of references. Let's learn how to stand on the Word of God for what it is, read it, and stand on it. See what the Lord is saying to us. And then when we've learned to do this, then we can move forward. And may the Lord grace you to do all of the reference you want. If you want to go and start reading other commentaries, to God be praised. But here, we want you to get the basic fundamentals of the truth, because I've learned that in our walk with God, our problems start because we have a lack of the foundation. We hardly read, but we want the blessings of the word as if we've been with God all of our lives. We want the blessings of God as if we've been with Him all of our life, and that we are very mature in the Word. But you'll find out that there are people who've been in church, who've been around Christendom, who've been professing salvation, and go to church faithfully, but they know very little about the Word of God. We're still having problems with God and His relationship with His people. We have problems understanding some things, and these things should be fundamental to us, Layla. God blessings to you. These things should be fundamental to us. We should understand it by now. But we're still getting it mixed up. You know, I look at all of the things that are happening in the world, and we're still missing it. We're still missing it. That here's the mother, and this is just giving a little introduction, not to a Joel just yet, but I just want to speak to your hearts a little bit. God is a loving God, caring God, awesome God. He's our Father. Our Father is the creator of the heavens and the earth. Our Father created the earth, and we're his children. Blessing to you, Prophetess Ruby. Blessings to you. God is our Father. He created the heaven. He created the earth. All that dwells therein. And we have the honor of calling him Father. And I thank God for that. And look like we should be at a place in our life that we should come to know a little bit more about God. Yes, I know that the scriptures tells us in the book of Daniel that the heavens does rule. The heavens rule. Look like man have things together. Look like man want to do what they want to do. But the Bible said that heavens rule. I understand it perfectly. But I also understand it that the gods of this world is not your apostles. The gods of this world are not the children of God. The gods of this world is under the auspices of principalities and powers, rulers of the darkness of this world, wickedness in high places, evil minions and evil dominions, and people who has a great disdainment of God. And if we're going to move in this life with great precision and tear down Satan's kingdom, then we really need to walk this life through in prayer and ask God to lead us daily, that we will hear his heart. Hear his heart. Read his word, but hear the heart of God. And that God would open our eyes and give us seeing eyes and hearing ears. These are the things that we desire of the Lord. People are looking, and a young mother who just go through life, has a child, gets in an accident, the baby loses life, the mother's wounded severely. And you would have people say, well, if your God is so great, if your God is so good, if your God is so awesome, if he's all of this and he's all of that, why didn't he save that child? Why didn't he save that mother? And you hear talks like this all of the time. Why didn't God intervene? What's going on with your God? Why didn't your God come to this woman's rescue? We hear it. And we would just, and our heart goes out to the mother. Our heart goes out to the child. But we who are the children of God, we can never forget that when we leave our houses, when we send our children off to schools, when we drive on the highway, when we are entering any place in this world, we want to invoke the presence of God upon our life. Father, lead us, guide us. Your eyes, we will look through your eyes. We will hear with your ears. Father, you lead us. You guide us. We are as sheep. We are as lamb in the midst of ravenous wolves. And this earth is governed by principalities and powers and rulers of the darkness of this world and wickedness in high places. And we need you to keep us. When we ask God to keep us, when we ask him to lead us and guide us, he does a marvelous job. It's only when we step out from under his protection, when we feel that we can do it our own selves, that nobody can tell us anything, and we got this on our own, that we run into our biggest headaches. But when we trust God, his word says, I will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on me. He cannot lie. He will order our steps in all that we do. And when we remember this and invoke his presence upon our life, And he would lead us. He would guide us. He would speak to us. He would orchestrate our life daily for us. He will do that. We won't have to worry about coming up missing in action. And we need God. Children, if you fail to pray, anything can happen. And we're at such a juncture in life that we really need God to help us. We really need God to intervene for us. If America is going to take a stand, and if America is going to come to their knees, if America is going to be led by God, then we need people praying. There's no person who are leading us, White House, Congress, or Senate, who have been running their campaign or running now or has been running, who will run and say, Father, I'm yours. You lead me and you guide me and I will follow you. If you will speak to me, I'll do whatever you say. We don't have such a leader that would say, Father, my ears is open to your heart. My eyes is open to see what you want me to do. And if we had such a person that would do that, God would help us. If we had people that would pray, if my people which are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven. I will hear from heaven. I'll forgive their sins. I'll heal their land. If they would simply humble themselves and pray, if this people would do that, God will hear. If we would do that, if you want to see God intervene in America, if you want to see God intervene in the situation that we have at hand, pray. Pray and ask God to lead us according to his heart. Give us people according to his heart. Save those who will lead this country. God, speak to them. Speak to their hearts. Speak to their minds. Speak into their ears. Let them hear. Regardless of their desires, regardless of their intent, you speak, Father, and turn this nation from the brink of destruction into the path in which you would have it go. If you want to see God, jump on that wagon of prayer and begin to invoke his presence, not only in your house, not only in your life, but in the life of the American people. That God would open up our eyes and cause us to see, open up our ears and cause us to hear. I was having a conversation not long ago with a family member. While we were talking, discussing some things, I was looking at how ingrained in this thing called politics they were. They were just ingrained in politics. And I was just sitting looking, and they were, oh my God, looked like they said it, that they spoke their piece with such venom, just heated. And I'm like, you know, if we had that passion for prayer, if we had that passion for God, if we had that passion to serve him, like people are really trying to figure what person is going to be this and what person is going to be that. I'm going to get behind this person because they're this. I'm going to get behind that person because this person is that. If you only knew, my brethren and my sisters, you know, there are a lot of ticking time bombs among us. There was one in the crowd with Jesus. We all knew him by the name of Judas. If you would have never jumped the pages, if you would have never ran ahead of the scriptures and went to the place where he delivered Jesus up to be crucified and begin to expose, begin to sneeze and squeal on him to turn him in,
if you did not read that all along, and you look back at the beginning of his ministry, Judas was a good guy. Judas walked with him. Judas was a passionate person. Judas was a man of prayer. Judas was a man of charisma. He even ascended to the ranks to be able to pray for people, and they recovered. To cast out devils, and they recovered. Judas looked like everything was going good for him. But there was something about Judas that he had, and Jesus knew it all along. But Judas did not know how to handle correction. Mary came and broke her alabaster box and began to write in Simon's house, began to weep at his feet and wipe her tears with her hair. And she broke the alabaster box, scenting up the place with this beautiful aroma. Judas was on the sideline, and he called all that a waste. This alabaster box belonged to Mary. The aroma in it belongs to her. But she wanted to put it on Jesus. And Judas had the audacity to call it a waste. The Lord knew what was in his heart, and the Lord rebuked and says, leave her alone. Let her alone. Shortly after the Lord spoke that, he could not handle it. And he went out of the place. He went out from the teaching, went out of the house. His spirit is broken. He's hostile. The Bible says from that occasion, the enemy saw an occasion to enter into Judas. And after he entered into Judas, Judas went out and betrayed him. But before he betrayed him, he looked like he was a good guy. Looked like he was measuring up, doing everything that he needed to do. Why am I talking about Judas? I know the stories are not about Judas. The story is about Joel and his prophecy. So while people are jumping on a bandwagon and says, I'm for this person and I'm for this person, don't ever get to the place where you stop. Says, wait a minute. This is a good place for prayer. This is a good place where I will be led by prayer. I will cast my vote based upon what the Lord says. And God, you will lead me. You will guide me. I want to follow your will. I will follow your desire, because that's what I'm going to do. Speak, Father. Let me be led of your spirit. Speak, Father. And if you would become so passionate about prayer, if you can become so passionate about prayer like you are about Biden, or passionate about prayer like you are about Trump, if you would become so passionate about prayer as you are about voting, become passionate about prayer and watch God intervene. And when you begin to talk to God, don't just say, God bless Biden, or bless Kamala, or bless Trump. No, no. Don't ask God to bless them. Ask God to lead us according to his heart. Turn our hearts to him. Forgive us of the sins we've committed. Bring us up and out of the muck and miry clay pit that we're in. Turn our hearts to him. Bring this place to a time of great revival. You're not going to know people based upon how they look, the color of their hair, male or female. You're not going to know them that way. But you will know them if you would spend time in prayer. And you begin to talk to God and ask God, what do I do? Which way do I go? If you begin to spend time in prayer and ask God to lead us and to spare our lives, spare our children, spare this nation. Turn us around. Turn us after your heart. Get our attention, God. And if you would do that, God know how to do it. He even raised up a people. Maybe that's not even on the ticket. He'll raise up somebody. If you would trust him, if you would do that, God know how to intervene. But if you silence your prayer, if you silence your voice, if you remain muted, and don't talk to God about this situation that you're facing, and anything happen, and then the way it go down, and then you are crying, you're hurting, the church is in a squeeze, the people is in a squeeze, your bank account is in a squeeze, what you believe is in a squeeze, and nothing is going right, and you have not opened your mouth to pray, don't blame anybody else. Ask yourself the question, why didn't I pray when I had a chance? Why didn't I get scriptures and bring those scriptures, begin to pray the scriptures, pray the heart of God, ask God to lead me, ask God to speak to me. Pray what the Lord says. Then when you do, when you've done these things, then you can move forward. And then if you want to join your Hancock and sign a petition, a sign who you desire to be the next leader, then by all means. But don't do that if you don't pray. Don't be disgruntled and frustrated because, you know, you're just going to just go forth and cast a vote. No. Talk to God. Please talk to God. Please ask Father to turn it around. Please ask him to help you. Please ask him to lead you and guide you and show you what to do and how to do it. When you've done these things, you've done it right. But if you sit back and do nothing and just remain silent, I'm just going to see how it goes. The least you can do is pray. And when you pray, I mean, cry aloud and spare not. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Show your people, the house of Jacob their sins. Cry aloud. Seek him like you've never sought him before. Because we are in the last days. Listen, went that route, but our lesson is about Joel. Let's look at Joel. The topic of this lesson, is cry aloud and howl, O children of God. The day of the Lord is at hand. The day of the Lord is at hand. When? Right now. The day of the Lord is at hand. The day of the Lord is at hand. And listen. Some of you, some of us, we've gotten a little comfortable because for 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 65, 75, 80 plus years, however long you've been on the face of the earth, you've been used to this pattern. You've been used to things happening like this. You've been seeing it day in and day out, and nothing has changed. And it is so easy to say, or to take that word lightly and say, cry aloud and howl, O children of God, the day of the Lord is at hand, and not know what that really means. You don't really know what the day of the Lord is about because you've never witnessed the day of the Lord. You've never seen the day of the Lord. You've only heard about the day of the Lord in this lesson. Blessings to you, missionary Brenda. I thank God for you. I was just at the beginning of the lesson telling the people about the great time that we've had with you. Amen. There in New York and how the people, you and the people and your pastor, and Dr. Kennedy, how you guys just, y'all set an unprecedented standard of excellence for us. And we appreciate you. Thank you. Thank you for your prayer ministry. Thank you for what you do. Thank you for the inroads that you're making. Don't ever stop. Keep doing what you do. You always got my support and my prayers. We're standing with you. Blessings of the Lord rest, rule, and abide with you. Amen. Joel is that man of God that not a whole lot is known about his personal life. He's not giving you much information about his personal life. But what he is speaking is coming to us in three chapters. And today's chapter is cry aloud and howl, O children of God, the day of the Lord is at hand. This is about 800 BC, some 800 years before Christ. It's in the first year, it's in the first verse that you hear a little bit about Joel, and this is all it says. The word of the Lord that came to Joel, the son of Bethuel. The word of the Lord came to him. The word, and it does not tell you that somebody brought it. Does not tell you that a preacher was preaching. It just said that the word of the Lord that came to Joel, the son of Pethuel. When you're at that place that you carry his presence and you know you walk with God and you know how to hear him and you know how God interacts with you, you know, and you can bodaciously say, the word of the Lord came to me. When you know how he speaks to you, this is what's happening with Joel. The word of the Lord that came to Joel, the son of Pethuel, and he is giving us what the word of the Lord says. This is at a time that you don't have what we know as the New Testament. He gives reference to some older scriptures. He gives reference to some old older writings. He gives reference to Isaiah and some other older writings, but or either they picks up writings, lessons from them, because to do this in this season, in this time, some 800 BC, perhaps Isaiah and some of the other writers grabbed something of what he was saying, because at this time, they haven't come on the scene. This is 800 years before Christ. He says, the word of the Lord that came to Joel, the son of Pethuel, and this is, he says, hear this. Who's he appealing to? Ye old men. Hear this, ye old men. The old men should walk in a level of respect. The people should have respect for the older voices, one who's been around a while, one who are carrying the name of the Lord, one who have been enlightened by the word of the Lord, one who know the plan of God or have ventured his path. They understand what it means to, and in that dispensation, bringing their sacrifice, seeking the face of God, hearing about the things of God, telling the stories about the things of God. And it should be the older men who are hearing this, and they're able to pass it from one generation to the next generation. And you hear that in verse number 3 as well. Verse 2, hear this, ye old men. Give ear, all ye inhabitants of the land. Has this been in your days, or even in the days of your fathers? Tell ye your children of it. Let your children tell their children, and their children another generation. And this is the reason why it's so important that he connect with the fathers, because fathers should have children, and children have children, and you have grands and great-grands, etc. And you can pass down this information as it was with Abram. Shall we keep this from him and not tell him what we're going to do? No. But we're going to tell Abram, because we know this man will lead his house. He will take care. He will take charge. He will lead his house. And if we don't know anything else about Abram, Abram is going to tell his house. He's going to tell the servants in his house. They're going to walk by a certain protocol, a certain curriculum of teachings. God knew that about Abraham. Does God know that about you? Does God know that if I tell Zeddy, if I tell Dexter, if I tell a different one, that they're going to leave their house? They're going to tell little Bobby Joe. They're going to tell little Leanne. They're going to tell little Stephen. And Stephen's going to tell Tanya. Tanya gonna tell Mike. Yeah, and they're gonna continue as they've enlightened with people. They're gonna tell their friends. They're gonna tell their neighbors. They're gonna tell the community. Before you know it, everybody know what's going on. And this is how it was with the children of Israel. Abraham knew the people. And then he knew how to pass that information to Isaac. Isaac knew how to pass it on to Jacob. And these were patriarchs that knew how to pass the story on about God. They knew how to pass it on. And while they were in Egypt, and while night after they finished working, no doubt they would sit around. No doubt. no doubt. They would sit around after they've finished their laborious work, and they could hear them talking about how it was in Abraham's day. God Almighty spoke to our fathers in Mesopotamia and told him that this is what I'm going to do, and I will bless your going out and whether you're coming in. He told us that we're going to be in bondage. He told us these things. And so they knew about God. The Bible tells us that they knew about God, because when Moses said to God, what do I tell them? Who would I say sent me? Tell them I am that I am has sent me, has sent you. Tell them that. They'll know. They'll know. Tell them, tell Pharaoh to let my people go. God has a claim on them. And they're going to warm up to you when you begin to tell them that I am has sent you. Somehow another 400 years later, after they went into Egypt, they were hearing the stories of what Abraham told them. Isaac has told them. Jacob has told them. Reuben and Gad and Dan and Naphtali and all the rest of begin to tell them that how God was with them. The people heard. The people believed. The people clung to that when there was no writing. They clinged on to that. And it made, yes, I know Moses still had a job to do, but it made it a little bit easier because the people knew who they were. And they knew they were not the Egyptians. They knew they were a different breed of people. Because somebody told them, if we would simply gather the people, rally the people, and tell them, pass this word on to them. Tell ye your children of it. Let your children tell their children and their children another generation. Stop saying, oh, Bobby's not going to hear me. Oh, little Larry's not going to hear me. If you teach them to hear you, parent, they will hear you. If you teach them the things of God, they will hear about the things of God. If you train up a child in the way that they should go, when they get old, they will not depart from it. If you would simply open your mouth and teach them, they will hear you. Tell ye your children of it, and let your children tell their children and their children another generation. That which the palmer worm has left has the locust eaten. And that which the locust has left has the cankerworm eaten. And that which the cankerworm has left has the caterpillar eaten. Can you imagine the palmer worm? The larva. This little destroyer. He's a destroyer now, but it looks like a larva. It looks like he's the smallest little pupil. He's a larva. He's just trying to get out of the shell, out of the little incubator, out of the cocoon. And then he starts devouring. He starts eating up the greenery because he knows he got to grow. He cannot walk on twigs. He cannot crawl on trees. He cannot survive if he does not eat. The larvae, the palmer worm. But he is a destroyer. There are some destroyers, you'll see them with your natural eyes. There are other destroyers, you won't see them because they're just incubating. Then when they come out, they're small. They're on the bottom of the leaf. You don't see them, but they're eating. Go back the next day, the whole leaf may be gone. The larvae is out. The larvae is eating. He has the same he has the same framework. He has the same intent. He is a destroyer. And he will devour. The palmer worm. He's the primary insect. He's the first echelon of eating and destroying. And this is the one people fail to see because this is the baby. You don't always see the baby, but the baby's got to grow. And when he has not eaten everything, that which the palmer worm has left has the locust eaten. You see the locust. He's the hopper. He's the crawler. And he comes in armies. You may not see the armies with the larvae. You may not see them like that, because you're going to have to look a little careful. You got to scrutinize the plant in order to see him. But the grasshopper, when you see him, guess what? Before he's gotten to become where he's at and become to that level, before he got to that level, he was at another stage in life. Yeah, he was eating his way to that. He too, the locust, is a devourer. He's the grasshopper devourer. He's a migrant. He's a migratory. He's constantly on the move. He is always migrating. He's always on the move, always consuming, always eating, always growing. He's a devourer. That which the larvae, the palmworm has left, has the locust eaten. And that which the locust has left, has the cankerworm eaten. And they often mistake this one too, because it's just another stage. Another stage devourer. All devourers doesn't look the same. Some devourers are babies. Some devourers are in a grasshopper stage. Some devourers are getting ready to metamorphose into another section, another stage of life. And just when you're thinking that you've got it down packed, there's a devourer that's laying dormant. Oftentimes, we don't see that one. We don't see that devourer that's laying dormant. And oftentimes, he don't want to lay dormant on your shoulder. He don't want to lay dormant on the exterior, but he want to lay dormant in your life. He want to lay dormant in your attitude, in your feelings, and in your emotions, in your dispositions, in your likes and your dislikes. He's a critter that you cannot see, but he's living within you. Who's sharing your body with you? Look out, Evangelist Brenda. Yeah, Evangelist Brenda, I got that book from Jesus, your pastor. Mm-hmm. I picked up that book, Who's Sharing Your Body With You? I like that title, Who's Sharing Your Body With You? That's that one. I want to see him as that one that lays dormant. You know, there's a spirit that lays dormant. He doesn't intervene with your birthdays. He doesn't intervene with your Bible study lessons. He doesn't intervene with your growing up, and you leaving from a teenage stage to your adolescent stage. He's not going to intervene when you're in those stages, when you're just doing, just being you, being a youth. When you're doing foolish things, he's not going to come up. He's not going to say anything. He's going to stay right there with you. Then all of a sudden, when you make a decision to follow the Lord, you yield your life to him and say, for you I live and for you I will die, Father. Then all of a sudden, that spirit that has been laying dormant for a long time begin to speak out, begin to antagonize you. There are some that has gone into a different stage. He's yet a devourer. He's yet doing the same thing as the palmerworm, the same thing as the locust, the same thing as the cankerworm. They're devouring, but they're doing it in different echelons, different stages of life. And we have to make sure, we who are the children of God, to be alert on every phase. Be alert and give no place to the devil. Give no place to the devil in nothing at all, especially in our mind, in our feelings, in our emotions, in our dispositions. They love to antagonize you with doubt, antagonize you with fear. Careful. Careful. That which the locust has left, has the cankerworm has eaten, and that which the cankerworm has left has the caterpillar eaten. In other words, the devourer don't want to leave anything. Pummel worm left something, the locusts come behind and get it. The locust left something, the cankerworm come behind and get it. And what the cankerworm has left, the caterpillar come behind and get it. After it's all said and done, there's nothing left. He is a devourer. Awake, ye drunkards. Weep and howl, all ye drinkers of wine, because of the new wine that is cut off from your mouth. What is this saying? What is this saying to us now? What is this saying to us this day? People of God, we have work to do. We have work to do. We have to really seek the face of God. And it's a time to come to the altar, seek the Lord like we've never sought him before. If you ever had doubt about your walk with God, this is the time to get it right. If your elevator has not been going all the way up to the next level, to the next floor, make it right. Make the proper adjustments. This lesson, this prophecy that Joel is speaking, it dealt with a specific people at a specific time. This lesson was applying to a group of people that had fallen in sin. But what's so unique about this prophecy is that just as he spoke it then, it had relevance today. This prophecy and what Joel is speaking, not just in the first chapter, second chapter, and third chapter, but these words are beneficial to us right now. We cannot look at this and say, oh, that was only for the people that lived 800 years before Christ. Baby, this is speaking to us now. This is also speaking to us in this dispensation right now. Awake, ye drunkards. Weep and howl, ye drinkers of wine, because of the new wine. For it is cut off from your mouth. You know, I thank God for the Holy Ghost. And don't let what I'm about to say mislead you or throw you off. Because the Bible did say that he'll give the Holy Ghost to them that ask for it. But a lot of people just have not been asking for the Holy Ghost. He will give it liberally, just like he will faith. Wisdom. He will give it to them liberally and upbraid it not. If you would just simply ask him for wisdom, he'll give it to you. And if you would ask him to be with you, he'll be with you. If you ask him in, invite him in, he'll come in. Peter asked him, Lord, if that's you walking on the water, let me come to you walking on the water. He said, simply come. He would not withhold no good thing from them that ask him. And how is it that no one else asked him? How is it that no one else walked on the water? Because no one else asked him to walk on water. Peter was the only one. And if you would ask him for the Holy Ghost, he'll give you the Holy Ghost. But we have been teaching this from a perspective that makes people feel that the day you give your life to Christ, you already have his spirit. You already have the Holy Ghost just by saying, Lord, forgive me, come into my life. And people begin to believe that they have the Holy Spirit. They fail to believe that the Holy Ghost is a working gift. It's a working gift. And it comes to lead you and guide you into all truth. And it will bring all things to remembrance whatsoever the Lord has said to you. And even if you've taken the time to read his word, he will bring that word back to your intent. He'll bring it back to your mind if you'd read it. But there are so many who said that we're saved and sanctified and Holy Ghost filled, fire baptized. And they'll say this, but yet fornicates, commits adultery, they'll lie, they're doing all these other things under the sun, but say that they have the Holy Ghost? Who's lying? Who's lying? Well, the Holy Ghost is definitely not a liar. But when people begin to say that from the day you gave your life to Christ, he give you his spirit. And then they begin to tell you something that from that point on, you begin to grow in grace in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I got that. I understand it very well. But I also understand one thing. I understand the difference between the National Guards and the Army. And when I was in the Army, I was in the Army. There was no mixing. There was no weekend warrior. There was no doing it on the weekend. When I was in the Army, I was in the Army every single day. Even on Sunday, I was in the Army. I belonged to Uncle Sam wanted to get credit, said that you belong to me, but I was in the Army. When I've gotten out of the Army and I switched over to a different branch of service, and then you can retain the title of military personnel, but your duties was limited. And then you can do your duties on the weekend, certain weekends out of the month, just 2 days, 2 days out of the month, and you was good. And they call them weekend warriors. That's a whole different viewpoint. But when you're in God all the time. Some of us want to serve God as if we are weekend warriors. We want to serve God as if we are National Guards. Only for call up. Only in time of emergency, then we are called up. But baby, you're going to miss something in the process. You're going to miss your drill. You're going to miss the alert. You're going to miss something. You're not going to have it all together. But when you're in Christ, and you're in there to stay, and you're learning of him, you're ready for whatever happens. The Holy Ghost is a working gift, and it leads you. He guides you into all truth. He brings stuff to your remembrance, whatsoever you have learned of what he has said to you. He brings it to your remembrance. You walk by a certain protocol with him. Yearning, eager to do what pleases him, not what displeases him. And when I read this verse, the fifth verse, awake, ye drunkards. Now, I know that this verse talks about wine. I don't want to look at the wine in the natural. But I want to look at it from the spiritual perspective that we are likening it to the new wine. Awake, ye drunkards, and weep and howl, all ye drinkers of wine, because of the new wine. What about the new wine? For it is cut off from your mouth. People told you that you have it. Maybe it's not like that. If you're not asking him for it, if you're not asking the Lord to keep you, if you're not asking him for his spirit, if you're not asking him to, you're not reading the word, so how's he going to bring it back to your remembrance? You didn't read the scripture, so he's not speaking to you. And you still, I can't hear what the Lord is saying. Read the scriptures. He'll speak to you. Get in the word and stay there. He'll speak to you. One thing about the Spirit of God and having the Spirit, you want to be close to God. You want to hear what the Lord is saying. You want to be involved with what he's doing. You want to have hearing ears and seeing eyes. You want to see what he sees and hear what he hears. Jesus would often steal away. He knew he had a task to do on earth, but he would steal away even at night, to involve himself with his father's doing and what his father's saying. And he come back and tell the disciples, he said, those things that I see my, I do those things. I tell you about those things that I see my father do. I share them with you. What are you going to share with me? What are you going to share? I want you to share something with me, but I don't want you to share your fleshly desire. I don't want you to share with me that you won the bingo game, that you just won the lotto. Now, I'm not concerned about those things, but I want you to share something with me that you've been with the Lord and the Lord shared something with you. That maybe I missed it, but I want him to share something. Share it with me. Share it with you. Share it. Don't let the wine, don't let the new wine be cut off because of the new wine, for it is cut off from your mouth. When you're not involving yourself with the things of God, you're not going to have the things of God. But when you involve yourself with the things of God, he'll give you the things of God. You'll be wise enough, understanding enough of the things of God. And then you won't have to worry about certain talking points. You'll be glad to just say, I'm one in the number. Father, thank you. Thank you for making me one in the number. Hallelujah. For a nation has come up upon my land. A nation has come up upon my land. When I look at this, I think about roaches. Shelly Worthy, God blessings to you. Bobby Bangs, I thank you. I think about roaches. I really do. You might say, roaches? Man, come on now. Roaches, what make you think about them? A nation has come upon my land, strong and without number. You know, there's this saying that if you see one, there are thousands of them that's hiding. Let me say that again. If you see one roach, there's thousands of them that are hiding that you don't always see them. They're lurking behind the crevices. They're lurking behind the walls, behind the doors. They don't want to be seen. Light is on, so they disperse. And you're in the midst of such a place where there's a nation that it endeth earth here with you. You are a nation of people. You are a peculiar people. You are a holy nation. You're a righteous people. But right in the midst where you are is an ungodly nation. A nation has come upon my land. It has encroached itself upon where you dwell. Strong and without number, whose teeth are the teeth of a lion, and he has the cheek teeth of a great lion. Yeah. Blessings, Sister Desaline. I see you, and blessings of the Lord rest, rule, and abide with you. We thank God for you. Amen. Thank you for, amen, your contribution, amen, to the things of God. God blesses. Hallelujah. For a nation has come upon my land. Think about that, people. A nation has come upon my land. When you have a house, a brand new house, no one there but you, you're in this house, and then all of a sudden you see this little varmint, this little insect come out of nowhere. There are thousands more right where that one's at. Don't just wait. No, get busy. Get busy early, because you've seen one, but there are thousands more. Don't wait until they infest. Don't wait until they get rooted and ground. They packed up. They done moved in. They're settled in. Now, eliminate them. But just as you can see them, and I know I use that little small story about the roaches, but guess what? There's a people that's among you, and they're not God's people. The Bible talks about the wheat and the tare. And it talks about how, but did not we sow good seed in the field? Yes, you did. So how is it that it has gathered tare around it? When you sow wheat, but it has tare, how is it that it's so tare that while men slip, an enemy had sowed tares among the wheat? An enemy has done this. So while you're praising, while you're glorifying God, while you're moving forward, an enemy is infiltrating your grounds, encroaching upon your faith, encroaching upon your belief in God. Yeah. And they has an agenda. An agenda to eliminate you. Trust me, they don't want to just cohabitate with you. They want to eliminate you. They want to silence your voice. They want to destroy you. That's why we were talking about the destroyer earlier. They are destroyers. They are devourers. They don't want to leave you anything. It may take a little bit, but the ultimate goal is to leave you nothing. He has laid my vine waste and barked my fig tree. He has made it clean bare and cast it away. The branches thereof are made white. Lament like a virgin girded with sackcloth for the husband of her youth. Somebody who's been married more than once, and they're somewhat apprehensive. But the virgin who has never been married, this is a first. She's ready to fight. He's ready to fight. He's not going to let it get away. This is his only. He's a virgin. She's a virgin. They've come together. And you're going to embrace this like it's super glue. You're going to embrace the things of God like there is no tomorrow. The only problem is right now we're in a dispensation. Now, Sister Stacy, we've been through people. We have a history. Most of us have a history in our life. We have a background. We have a record. We have people that we can mark off. That one, this one, this one, that one, that one. That we've been through already. So meeting another person, just like meeting another person. It is so sad of us. But for this person, that verse 8, lament like a virgin have never had. This is going to be the first. You're not entering it to divorce. You're not entering it to break it up. You're not entering it to destroy it. You want it to last forever. Lament like a virgin girded with sackcloth for the husband of her youth. Willing to pray, willing to intercede, willing to just be there, ready to go to fight. To fight for the husband of her youth. The meat offering and the drink offering is cut off from the house of the Lord. The priest, the Lord's minister, mourn. I know in that dispensation, it was necessary that you bring a goat, a heifer, bullock, turtle dove, ram, sheep, pigeon. I think I said turtle dove. But you bring it, you offered up your sacrifice. And when they did not have a sacrifice, it bothered the people. That if I'm going to get to God, I got to bring him something. I got to bring something to God. And they felt that if they could not bring a sacrifice to God, that they retained their sins. That if I'm going to get my sins forgiven, I need to have something to give God. I need to be able to bring something that is acceptable, something that is fitting, something that is right for repentance. John was beginning to say, listen, while he was baptized, bring fruit that is fitting, that is worthy. Bring something. Don't come empty-handed. Bring something worthy for repentance. Show that you really mean this. Show that you are, this is of good faith. I really mean this, John. I'm coming. I have a heifer, turtle dove, ram, bullock, sheep, goat. Whatever they had, they were willing to bring that. It was fitting for repentance. And here, it's like a spinoff on that. The meat offering and the drink offering is cut off from the house of the Lord. The priest, the Lord's minister, mourn, mourn. You want to come up empty. You want to come. You want the blessings of it, but you don't want to bring anything. You want the blessings of the firstborn. You don't want to bring anything. You want the blessings of the dot connector, of the prophet, the blessings of the intercessor. But you don't want to bring anything worthy to give before God. Learn how to do that. Learn how to give. While I'm on that point, I want to say this to intercessor and I did say intercessor, evangelist Sterling. Amen. God see your heart. He knows your heart. And just as you went in the bowels of your heart to give to a worthy cause, to show that, listen, I appreciate you who've been standing with us. I appreciate your heart, appreciate your love. And you want to show something kind to them. You went into your savings. You went into your account and begin to sow that into their lives. God will always reward you handsomely. You'll never be able to get away and not receive the blessings of the Lord. The blessings of the Lord shall run you down and overtake you. God blessings to you. I thank God for you because you don't see it yet. But so many people were blessed because of your desire to push them into another echelon of the Spirit. So God bless you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. My God. Don't let the drink offering, don't let your gift to God, don't let your praise to God, don't let your sacrifice to God, don't let your devotion to God dry up. Don't let your prayer life before God dry up. Don't let your willingness to be dependable before God dry up. The field is wasted. Let me back up. The meat offering and the drink offering is cut off from the house of the Lord. How are we going to correct this? How are we going to make this right? The meat offering, the drink offering is cut off from the house of the Lord. Now, when you see that the meat offering and the drink offering is cut off from the house of the Lord not even talking to the laity. Now, the laity do have a purpose. They do have a something to do. But look at the scripture. Look at the prophecy. The prophecy is holding the priest. He's holding the ministers of God accountable. He's holding them accountable. And so that's why verse 9 speaks to the priest. Verse 9 speaks to the Lord's ministers. And he calls them, challenges them to cry, mourn. Leaders, mourn. You want people to get behind you and support you. You want them to know about this. You want people to learn about the things of God. I know, I do too. Yes, I want people to hear about God. Yes, I want them to be affected by this teaching. Yes, I want them to grow in grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Yes, I want to be able to be impactful in their life. But this word calls on us, the leaders, to do what? Mourn and cry. We get before him. We cry out to the Lord. We who are leaders, we cry out to God on the behalf of the people and this ministry and what God wants to do. And we ask God to show us your heart concerning our ministry and where you have us to go, what you have us to do, and how we can impact others' lives. He will do that. The field is wasted. The land mourneth. The corn is wasted. The new wine is dried up. The oil languishes. The oil is dried up. In other words, if you want to see it, if you want to see plenty, if you want to see blessings, if you want to see the land become green again, fruitful again, productive again, you want to see the blessings begin to flow again, this is a call to the leaders to cry out unto God. He hold us responsible for allowing the wine to dry up. He hold us responsible for allowing the corn to be wasted. He hold us responsible. You don't hold the workers responsible for the harvest being overran. You don't hold the workers responsible for that. No, you hold accountable the people who are responsible for the harvest. Be ye ashamed. There it is, right there. The next verse. Be ye ashamed, O ye husbandmen. You the one. Be ashamed, ye husbandmen. How, oh ye vine dressers. You're the one that works the vine. You're the one that dresses it. You're the one that keeps it. You're the one that prunes it. You're the shapers of lives. You're the dot connectors. Be ye ashamed, O ye husbandmen. How, O ye vine dressers, for the wheat and for the barley, because the harvest of the field is perished. Luke chapter 10, verse 2. Therefore said he unto them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. It's up to us to look on the fields, to witness and see that the harvest is ripe, to see that it is overlaid, it is ready, but that the laborers are few. And it's up to us to cry out to God, Lord, send laborers into your vineyard. And the first one he's going to send is you. Be willing. Be ready. The vine is dried up. The fig tree languishes. The pomegranate tree. The palm tree also and the apple tree. Even all the trees of the field are withered because joy is withered away from the sons of men. Notice. David Ashley, my friend, God bless you, my brother. Notice in verse 12, the vine has purpose. The vine is useful, but the vine is dried up. The fig tree has purpose. The fig tree is useful, but the fig tree languishes. The palm tree is fruitful. The palm tree has purpose, but the palm tree is dried up. The palm tree, the apple tree, and all the trees of the field, they have purpose. But all of them are withered. Why? Because joy is withered away from the sons of men. Oh, when the sons of men rejoice. Oh, when the sons of men will shout and cry out to God, and you begin to hear that baritone cry, that bass cry, that tenor voice, when you begin to hear men cry out to God, and that the whole land begin to ring with the voices of men, when men begin to seek the face of God and say, rise me up, oh God, raise me up. God will raise you up. God will hear you. God will deliver you. Don't become emasculated because you have people who are saying that I'm a boss girl. I'm a boss lady. You don't have to. So let them. If that's who they are, that's them. That's not you. That's not your framework. I know, men, it bothers you. I know it's a great disrespect to you. For the men of God, yeah, we know who you are. For those of you who have been called by God, I know it may seem a little flirting. I know it may seem a little different for you. Because the framework is when you want somebody that you can be with and stay with and live with and love. And when they start, and when our women begin to stand and say that they are the boss. They're the boss daughter. They're the boss girl. They're the queen. They run this joint. They're the one that's doing this. And I know what how they do it. It may make you feel somewhat taken a back seat. Well, they're on their path. They're on their journey. They're doing something different that does not have the plan of God upon it. Now, listen, we may say what we want to, but that just goes to show how far off the beaten path we've gotten. We've gotten away from the plan of God. We would rather have emasculated men beneath us so we can control, manipulate, and speak down to them. And we think it's fine because America and the nations think it's fine. But God have never accepted it as fine. What God desires is that men, you stand up and you take your right place. Because God wants to use you. God wants to use your brethren. God wants to use your men. God wants to use men in their prayer life, in the drive, in the fortitude, in your vision, and in your tunnel visionness. God wants to use you. My time is about up, but we're going to look at this word and we're going to finish this lesson today. The field is wasted, the land mourneth, for the corn is wasted, the new wine is dried up, the oil languishes. Be ye ashamed, O ye husbandmen, how, O ye vine dressers, for the wheat and for the barley, because the harvest of the field is perished. The wine is dried up, the vine is dried up, and the fig tree languishes, the pomegranate tree, the palm tree also, and the apple tree, even all the trees of the field are withered. Because joy is withered away from the sons of men. And I would love to put here the daughters of men. But this scripture is written like this for a purpose. Because it's speaking to the heart of men who should have the foresight, who should have a drive, who God is calling to accountability. God is calling you men to accountability. You dropped the ball, you backed up, you sat down, you allowed yourself to be overran. God is saying, get up. Get up, dust yourself off, jack yourself up, grab your seat by the seat of your britches, and says, I've got to get back and do what my father has called me to do. You've got to do it. It's nobody's fault but your own if you do not do the things of God. You're not going to answer to God and say, well, Lord, the woman you gave me. Now, God didn't want to hear it when Eve said that. I mean, Adam said that. But no, God is calling you to accountability, brethren. God is calling us to work. God is calling us to protection. God is calling us to protect what we have, our family. God is calling us to the priesthood. God is calling us to foresight, to insight, to follow his plan. God is calling us to another level in him. Gird yourself. Lament, ye priest. Lament, lament, lament. Cry with a piercing cry. Lament, ye priest. Howl, ye ministers of the altar. Come, lie all night in sackcloth, ye ministers of my God. For the meat offering and the drink offering is withholden from the house of your God. The blessings that you once knew, or your fathers once knew, you wanted. And you wonder how come you're not walking in the gift of healing. You wonder how come you're not walking in the gift of deliverance. You wonder how come you're not walking in the gift of prophecy, the gift of discerning of spirits. How come you're not walking in the gift of wisdom and or miracles and or healing. And you wonder how come you're not walking in it. God is not going to give his spirit to anybody. God's not giving his spirit to anybody to just do whatever they want to do just because you're in a different dispensation. And then people say it's okay. It's okay to gamble, but yet, you know, you love God. It's okay to do bingo. It's okay to do raffles. It's okay to yet love God, but yet you're doing all these other things. And you're wondering how come his spirit is not moving on you like it moved on your mother and father. And you're searching your life like, what am I doing wrong, God? When you go back to the foundation, go back to the basics, and say, Lord, help me. Open up my understanding. And then he start pruning you. And you start cutting off some things. Walking away from some things. Leaving off some things. That look like you say, oh my God, my mom didn't do that. My daddy didn't do that. Oh my God, here I am. I'm guilty of these things. I'm rolling dice. I'm shooting dice. And I'm going to the casinos. And I'm, you know, doing these things. And I want to take some me time for me. And do this for me. And my people didn't even do this. And they walk in the gift of God fluently. But how come it's not working in you? You want too much. You want to carry extra baggage. And God says, no, I'm still the same. The same that it took for your mother and father, it's going to take for you and even in this dispensation. Sanctify ye in fast. Call a solemn assembly. Gather the elders and all the inhabitants of the land. not just the elders, not just the leaders. Now, call all the inhabitants of the land unto the house of the Lord your God. Cry unto the Lord. It didn't say out in the fields, but it said unto the house of the Lord your God. Why unto the house of the Lord your God? Because the house of the Lord your God should be a place of intercession, should be a place of discernment, should be a place where of spiritual encounter, should be a place where God can meet you and you can meet God. Should be a place that you don't have to worry, am I in the right place? The house of God should be a place of encounters. And last for the day of the Lord is at hand. When? Right now. The day of the Lord is at hand. And as a destruction from the Almighty shall it come. Is not the meat cut off from before your eyes? Yeah. Is not the meat cut off from before your eyes? People who walked in the Spirit of God and begin to do certain things in the Spirit of God, you saw a difference about their life. Now you're speaking in tongues, and now you're doing all kind of things that look like you're speaking in tongues, but yet you're playing. You're speaking in tongues, but yet you're playing God on Christendom. You're playing like you're happy. You're playing like you're happy, and you know it. And you're speaking in tongues, but there's no results. There's no fire. There's no charisma. There's no God in it. It's been cut off, baby. Been cut off. Sanctify your fast. You want to get it back? Sanctify your fast. Call a solemn assembly. Gather the elders and all the inhabitants of the land unto the house of the Lord your God and cry unto the Lord. You want to see a move of God? Cry unto the Lord. You want to see God come into the place? Cry unto the Lord. And last for the day of the Lord is at hand. And as a destruction from the Almighty shall it come. Is not the meat offering, is not the meat cut off from before your eyes? And yea, joy and gladness from the house of our God? Yes, but if you would cry out, if you would seek his face, if you would seek him like there is no tomorrow, God will turn that around. The seed is rotten under their clod. Yeah, the seed is rotten under the ground. The seed is rotten. Clay. Look like it just congealed itself upon the seed and it cannot breathe. It cannot do what it needs to do. The garners are laid desolate. The barns are broken down. The corn is withered. How do the beasts groan? The herd of the cattle are perplexed because they have no pasture. They have no place to feast. They have no place to eat. How do they groan? Because they have no pasture. Yea, the flock of sheep are made desolate. Oh Lord. And this is what we as a people need to do. Oh Lord, to thee will I cry. For the fire has devoured the pasture of the wilderness. The flame has burned all the trees of the field. The beasts of the field cry also unto thee. For the river of waters are dried up. And the fire has devoured the pasture of the wilderness. I know my time is up, but here's our cry. Our cry should be, Father, not on my watch. Don't let the rivers of water dry up. Don't let your spirit dry up in me. God, give me seeing eyes and hearing ears. Don't let your grace, don't let your anointing dry up in me. Don't let me become blind and spiritual deaf that I cannot hear. Father, open my eyes and cause me to see. In the name of Jesus. For not only am I asking you to cause me to see, but Father, I pray now that you'd call me to raise up intercessors. Call in intercessors, raise up and hear the voice of God. Hear ye the voice of the Lord. Cry out and cry now and seek him like there is no tomorrow. Cry ye ministers of the altar. Stand up wherever you are. Come out wherever you are. Hear the word of the Lord. Be broken. Of a contrite spirit, he will in no wise despise. See the degradation of this nation. See the brokenness of this people that have seem as though they have no shepherd. Cry unto the Lord your God. Make this your prayer. Don't just listen to me, but make this your prayer. Father, make me useful. Utilize me in this season. Use me, oh God. Use me in prayer. Use me, oh God. Use me as a dot connector. Use me to cry aloud. Oh God, today I cry before thee. Turn your hearts. Turn us to your heart. Turn us to your heart. Turn our hearts to you, oh God. Forgive us of the sins we've committed. Break up our fertile ground. Break down our stubborn will. Father, we seek you. Father, we seek you. We seek you, God. In the name of Jesus, we seek you. We seek you, Lord. We seek you, Lord. Listen, my time is up. I've got to get ready to go. Hallelujah. But if you ever need God, that time is now. And this is the time to ask God, Lord, turn your heart. Turn our hearts to you. Turn our eyes towards you. Turn our ears towards you. Turn our families towards you. Turn our communities towards you. Turn our nation towards you, our state, our county towards you. Turn America towards you. Turn Georgia to you, God, in whatever state you're from. Would you pray for your state? Would you pray now? Would you take a few minutes and you begin to call on God for your community? Call on God for your state? Call on God for this America? That God would lead us and guide us? And would you talk to God about it? Don't become muted. Don't sit there and do nothing. But how about opening your voice to God and ask God to lead us? And don't make this about a political prayer. No, don't make this a political prayer. Don't pray for your normal your normal party, whoever party you're on, whether you're on the Republican Party or the Democrat. No. Why don't you just pray and say, God, you intervene. You intervene. But raise your people up. Protect your people in this dispensation. Give your people your heart, God. Oh, God, hear the cry of your people, God. And the people are saying, Father, lead us. Come into this nation. Lead us, oh, God. Lead us by your standard. Lead us by your spirit, God. Speak to us in this dispensation, God. We want to hear from you, God. Father, lead us. Lead us. Lead us. Everything that's not of you, move it. Everything that's not of you, tear it down. Oh God, move it out of our way, God. We've been fooled. We've been bamboozled and hoodwinked, God. We've been lied to for so long. Father, open up our understanding to truth. Open up our eyes to truth. Open our ears to truth. Father, enter into our hearts. Lead us by your spirit. Give us your spirit. Give us your spirit. Give us hearing ears and seeing eyes, oh God. We dedicate our life to you. Father, hear us. Hear us this day. Forgive us where we went wrong. And we give you the praise and the glory and honor is yours. In Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So many have fallen by the wayside, but we need God to help us this day. Listen, tune in tomorrow for the next edition as we go to chapter 2 of this great book of Joel. Joel chapter 2. Those of you who are just now following us for the first time, come read through chapter 2 and 3. Be willing to follow along with us. For those of you who are just now following us for the very first time, we're not trying to go deep into the Word of God as a seminary or a great theologian, but we just want to deal with the basics of stuff that we should have already read through. That's why we take it verse by verse, chapter by chapter. We're going through the book of the Bible. Follow along with us. And in your time, when you're doing your own private study, then by all means, run your references, read your commentary, do whatever you want to do. But here, we just want to take time and follow it scripture by scripture, verse by verse, and be a part of this Bible study and pray for us. We may not do it the way you would do it. Pray for us that God will enlighten us even the more. All right, we thank you. God bless you. God keep you in heaven. Smile upon you. For that person that do not know the Lord, it's very easy to come to him. Come with a willing heart. Come with a willing heart and say, Lord, if you would follow this prayer, if you would just say this prayer with me, if you don't know him, this is your first time being illuminated to Bible study, to Bible teaching, to church, or however, and you want to make a change, and you've heard about God, you've heard about his son, Jesus Christ, and you're having some problems, just simply say, Father, I come to you this day. Forgive me of all the sin that I've committed. And this day, I invite you into my life. From this day forward, you lead me, you guide me, and speak to my heart. Teach me how to hear you. Teach me how to observe you through your word. Father, I pray now that thou would turn my life completely around. I give you my life, my heart, my soul, and my thoughts. And this day, I accept you as my Savior. And the Bible says, in John 1 and 12, as many as receive him, to them he give power to become the sons of God, to them that believe on his name. If you would simply believe on his name right now, say, Lord, I accept you as my Savior. The Lord grant you power today to live. And may you live today. Follow us on tomorrow that we'll go another further, that you'll step into another echelon to take you even farther than what you've come to learn today. In Jesus' name, go in peace, my brother, my sister, and God walk with you. In Jesus' name, be blessed. God bless you to everyone.